Well, can we actually talk about the suffering?
Sure.
The darkest parts of writing a book. So let's go to the full Michael Malice, Stephen King mode of what are the darkest moments of writing this book? And what is it? Maybe start the white pill. What's the idea? What's the hope? And what are your darkest moments around writing this book?
So people are familiar with the red pill and the blue pill. They're from the Matrix. The red pill is the idea that what is presented as fact by the corporate press entertainment industry is in fact a carefully constructed narrative designed to keep some very unpleasant people in power and everyone else under control. And as one of my expressions is, you take one red pill, not the whole bottle.
Yes.
Because at a certain point, you think everything's a lie, and then you're kind of no capacity for distinguishing truths.
You're full of good one-liners.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
I'm full of something, that's for sure. And what I saw in this space is a lot of these red-pilled people got very disheartened and cynical. And one of my big heroes is Albert Camus, and he said the worst thing is cynicism. And that's led to something called the black pill, which is the idea that, you know, it's just we're waiting for the end. It's hopeless. And I don't see it that way at all. And I'm like, all right, I have to address this, and not just with some kind of cheerleading, everything's gonna be great, guys. Here is why I am positive. And not that I'm positive the good guys are gonna win, but I'm positive the good guys can win. And that's all you need. Because if your, God forbid, kid is kidnapped and there's a 10% chance that you can save them, you're not going to be like, well, I don't like those odds. This is your country. This is your values. This is your family. And I think it's much more than 10%. And even if you lose, you will take pride in that you did everything in your power to win. So,
is there a good definition of good guys in the sense
that the ones who wear white?
There's layers to this. You're like modern day Shakespeare. Is there a danger in thinking Adolf Hitler was probably pretty confident that he led a group of good guys?
Listen, if Hitler did anything wrong, why isn't he in jail? My Czech friend thought of that joke. he says in his accent, he goes, if Hitler's so bad, why isn't he in the jail?
That's a good point. He's probably still alive, right?
And look, yeah, hopefully.
Oh, boy. Two of the three people listening to this are very upset right now. What were you even talking about? Oh, how do you know what is good?
There's lots of standards of good. But for me, to be a good guy is if you want to leave the world a little bit better than you found it. That, to me, is the definition of a good guy. And I think there are many people that's not their motivation at all.
Oh, so it's about your motivation.
Well, it's also about if your motivation is at all correlated to reality. No one thinks we're the bad guys. That's correct. But are you taking steps to check your motivations? And also, it takes a certain amount of humility. Because if you're going to start interfering with other people's lives, you really better be sure you know what you're talking about.
The control of others, if you do have centralized control, or then you become a leader of a group, you better do so humbly and cautiously.
And also have steam valves, right? So if in case things go wrong, I'm sure this is a lot happening with AI, whatever, or with computers. Like, okay, if something goes wrong here, how do we have a workaround to make sure it doesn't cause everything to collapse?
Yeah, the going wrong thing, I mean, the whole feedback mechanism.
Yeah.
Like, I wonder if people in Congress think that things are really wrong.
It's working for them.
Are you sure?
Because no, I'm not sure.
Because I'd like to believe that the people that at least when they got into politics actually wanted, some of it is ego, but some of it is like wanting to be the kind of person that builds a better world.
Sure. I also think it's diverse. Some who are going to have different motivations than others.
But like, once you're in the system and trying to build a better world, how do you know that it's not working? Like, how do you take the basic feedback mechanisms and like, and actually productively change? I mean, that's what it means to be a good guy. It's like, something is wrong here. And that's why I like the Elon Musk, like, think from first principles. Like, wait, okay. Let's ask the big question. Like, can this be, is this working at all? Like, the way we're solving this particular problem of government, is this working at all? And then, like, stepping away and saying, like, as opposed to modifying this bill or that bill, or like this little strategy, like increase the tax by this much or decrease the tax by this much. Like, why do we have a democracy at all? Or why do we have any kind of representative democracy? Shouldn't it be a pure democracy? Or why do we have states, like representation of states and federal government and so on? Why do we have this kind of separation of powers? Is this different? Why don't we have term limits? Or not, like big things. Like, how do you actually make that happen? And is that what it means to be a good guy? It's like taking big revolutionary steps as opposed to incremental steps.
Well, I don't know that you could be a politician to be a good guy, to be honest. And let me give you a counterexample of someone who you can tell is not being a good guy. Joe Biden said he regards the Iraq war as a mistake, okay? You and I have made mistakes in our lives, I'm sure. None of our mistakes have caused tens of thousands of people to die.
Speak for yourself.
That's fair. Okay, I'll take that. I don't build the kill bots. if I were a chef, let's take it out of politics, and in my restaurant, somehow, accidentally, someone ate something and they died. I would feel horrible. But more importantly, I would be like, we need to look through this system and figure out how it got to the point where someone lost their life, because that can never happen again. And we need to figure out step by step. I'm not a gun person, but there's like this checklist of like, if you're holding a gun, there's five things to do. And even if you get two wrong, you're going to be safe. It's like, assume every gun is loaded, only pointed at something that you want to kill. And there's like three other things. And it's like to make sure that nothing goes wrong. So if I'm that chef, and I would have to not only feel guilt, but take preventative action to make sure this has no possibility of happening again. If you look at the staff he's putting in, it's the same warmongers that would have advised him to get into the Iraq war on the first time. That is, to me, is not a good guy. That to me is someone who does not feel remorse for their responsibility in killing not only many Americans, but some of us think that, you know, dead Iraqis isn't necessarily ideal either.
Okay, let's talk a bit about war. Maybe you can also correct me on something. The first time I found myself into Barack Obama was, I don't know how many years ago this was, but when I maybe heard a speech of his about him speaking out against the war.
Yeah.
And him, I think it's on record saying he was against the war before it was happening. Now,
he wasn't in Senate at the time, so it was very easy for him to say this.
People say that. People say like it was easy, and some people say it's like strategically the wise thing to do, given some kind of calculus, whatever. But I, to this day, give him, that's the reason I've always given him props. In my mind, like,
okay,
this is a man of character. Like, I also personally really value great speeches. I think speeches are really important for leaders because they inspire the world.
It's that's fair.
One of the best things you can contribute to the world is great, like through intellect, mold ideas in a way that's communicable to like a huge number of people.
Yeah, I think it's better to persuade than to force in every instance.
Yeah, that's where I disagree with Chomsky. He said like, Chomsky's whole idea was that like, if you're a really eloquent speaker, that means your ideas aren't that good.
That's nonsense.
Yeah. So I think that's a way for him to describe like, I speak in a very boring way. Maybe that's a pitch for this podcast. I speak boring so that the ideas are the things you value. And it's also useful to go to sleep. But that's why I really liked Obama throughout his life and still do. But when I first like saw this, is for some reason, you can disagree, I thought he's a man of character. It's when most politicians, most people who are trying to calculate and rise in power, I think were for the war or too afraid to be against the war.
Yeah.
That's why I liked Bernie Sanders, and that's why I liked, like, in the early days, Obama for speaking out against the war. And not like in this weird activist way, not weird, but not saying I'm an activist, but like just saying the common sense thing and being brave enough to say the common sense thing without like having a big sign and saying I'm going to be the anti-war candidate or something like that, but just saying this is not a good idea.
And I think it's for those of us who are old enough to remember, it's pretty despicable what happened with Tulsi in 2020. She was the biggest anti-war candidate and she was marginalized within her own party, which I guess you can make sense. She's just a congresswoman from Hawaii. But the corporate press did everything in their power to diminish her and pretend she didn't exist. And for those of us who remember where 12 years prior, when George W. Bush had the Republican National Convention in New York, and it was like the biggest protest in history, and the Iraq War led to Democratic landslides in 2006 and 2008, to have that completely not part of the Democratic Party in 2020 is both shocking and reprehensible.